Hi everyone, welcome back to Vintage. There's a change in the air, things have definitely got colder. I've even got my vintage red jumper on. In fact, I'm hoping that this doesn't mean that I'm going to turn into a sort of disembodied head floating around. Rest assured, I'm here in body and spirit and everything. Last week I was talking about War and Turpentine by Stefan Hertmans. It's a fantastic book, and the weird thing is, because I had read it some time ago, doing the video last week reminded me about the book an awful lot, and I've been thinking about it in the past week, and indeed talking to people at work about it who had read it, and it really is a brilliant, brilliant book, and could well be, as Neil Mukherjee had described it in his review in The Guardian, as a future classic. So if you're not one of the two lucky people to win a copy, do check it out. If it sounds like the kind of book you think you might like, pick it up in a bookshop, read the first page or two, see how you feel. It might just grab you there and then. So well worth having a look at. I did have two copies to give away, and the lucky people winning those are Aaron Dix and Benjamin Churchill. Congratulations, both of you. I think you're both new subscribers or new commenters anyway. Lovely to see you. You will find my email address at the bottom of this video's description. Send me your postal addresses and I'll get copies of War and Turpentine off to you as soon as I can. This week, I'm talking about this book. This is The Schooldays of Jesus by J.M. Coetzee. Now, this was longlisted for the Booker Prize this year and is a sequel of sorts, a follow-on book from The Childhood of Jesus. And so I'm in a slight quandary about how to talk about this book, because of course some of you may have read the first book, some of you may not. I don't want to sort of spoil anything, but let's start off by spoiling straight away and saying that there is nobody called Jesus in this book. That's the first thing to say. There is a boy called Davíd, and very quickly, and without spoiling anything hopefully, in the first book Davíd arrives in the city with a boatload of other people, and he seems to be looking for his mother, and a man called Simón finds him and says that he'll help him find his mother, and they find this woman called Inés, and she seems to take on the role of mother without necessarily being his mother. It's all sort of slightly strange, and they become this sort of rather unorthodox family unit, and we sort of follow them in the first book, and there is a sort of a need to avoid the authorities to a certain extent because they don't have any papers that make them a family, because they don't really seem to be. So they're sort of avoiding the census takers throughout the book. Ooh, census, that might remind you of something to do with Jesus. Anyway, it's an allegorical tale, and the school days of Jesus picks up with Davíd now 7 years old, and the family have moved to a different city because of their need to avoid the authorities. And what happens in this book? Well, this is the funny thing. It's been causing a little bit of consternation amongst book reviewers, because people are reading it and kind of going, what the hell is all that about? And I kind of felt the same way when I read The Childhood of Jesus, the first book. If you've read any Coetzee before, you sort of think you might know what to expect from a book by him. And that it's a bit of a curveball, because it's all very allegorical, metaphorical. It's all very confusing as to what is real, what is not, or what is going on, and why the book is called The Childhood of Jesus. And I'm not going to pretend that anything changes with this second book. It is still slightly baffling. But that doesn't bother me in the way that it seems to bother some of the reviewers, who are doing an awful lot of chin scratching and sort of wondering whether Coetzee has lost the plot. We don't know, of course, exactly where this is going until this sort of cycle of books presumably is finished, because from reading this one and finishing it, it certainly feels like there's more to come. Now, of course, there's a few jokes you can make. What comes after The Childhood and The School Days of Jesus? What we're going to have, like the gap year of Jesus, the disappointing entry-level job of Jesus? You know, anything could happen. But I do feel like there is obviously more to tell. And once the work of art is finished, then maybe we can really scratch our chins and go, what was all that about? And it will certainly, I hope, become much clearer by the end of it. It doesn't feel like the end of a project right now. Anyway, age seven, what we're looking at here is David sort of going to school, but it's a very unorthodox school that he goes to in this book. He goes to a dance school, as you may have guessed from the cover of the book. And even the dance that he does there is unconventional. It's all about the calling down of numbers, rather than sort of classical ballet or anything like that. And it's sort of very hard to work out what that exactly means. But what's really interesting is that his father, Simon, in the book, is struggling to understand it too. And this is why I particularly enjoyed this book. And I'm going to use the word enjoy, because it made me laugh an awful lot. Because Simon, as a father, is almost permanently baffled by what's going on around him. He's baffled by this sort of strange relationship that he has with Inés. They become more estranged as this book goes on. And he's slightly baffled about how he's supposed to be a good father to David. He's certainly baffled about what's going on at that school. He's confused by his feelings for various people. And in many ways, that's kind of what being a dad is like. It's a bit baffling. It's a bit confusing at times to work out what's the right thing to do. And there's something I think very modern about that as an idea, where this idea of male crisis, men wondering how they're supposed to fulfill their role. I don't know that it's a particularly modern thing, really. As David Saloy said when we spoke to him about All That Man Is, you know, he said, if there is a male crisis, when has there not been a male crisis? You know, men are constantly working out how to fulfill roles that have been assigned to them, or all the rest of it. So I found it really interesting from that point of view. And that's why I find it hard to get too chin-strokey about it, because I immediately related to lots of stuff in this book, whilst, of course, the actual plot of it is slightly confusing and baffling, and I'm still no clearer in my mind as to where it's sort of heading or what it's really about. But it felt like it was very much about being a man, and it felt like it was also very much about, for some of the female characters in the book, what it means to be an object of male desire with a threat of violence that is constantly attached to that. And it's also about, I think, refugees in a weird way, because this rather rootless family is constantly, you're reading through the book about people looking for a sense of attachment in a foreign land. And if there's anything that we have learnt this year, of this sort of 2016 year of horrors, that there's been very much in the news the idea of refugees, people looking for refuge, for solace somewhere, being rejected by people in the countries where they might end up. It seems to be incredibly contemporary in a way that a lot of contemporary novels aren't. So with this allegory, I felt like he was touching on something that was incredibly relevant and seemed to become even more relevant as the year has progressed. So I think really interesting in that way as well. I think that's all I can say without really spoiling it, or sort of basically just reading the whole book out to you, which I'm not going to do. A confusing one, but I'm really enjoying the ride, and there is no doubt that Coetzee can write. Two Booker Prizes would attest to that. So I look forward to seeing what happens to Jesus next. If you are interested in winning a copy, the same rules apply as ever. Make sure you're a subscriber, leave a comment below, and I will pick two winners next week. That's all for this week. I'll see you next week. Take care.